What do you need, Briggs? Captain, how long are we going to be on this patrol? Orders are orders. We'll be here as long as it takes. I understand orders, but we are an elite fighting team. We're not supposed to be babysitting dead bodies stuck in a hillside. You can count on maybe one more night. Just get back to your post. Got all the evidence we could out of there. There wasn't much evidence inside, but I'll get it to you by Wednesday. We searched for the body, but there's no trace of it anywhere.
State your relationship with Jesus.
I was one of his secret disciples. I am one of the leaders on the council, and I didn't want to jeopardize my position, and I felt that I could support Jesus more from my position.
That was a bold move, asking Pilate for the body of Jesus. Were you alone?
No, I wasn't. Nicodemus, one of the council priests, was with me.
What did you use to prepare his body?
100 pounds of myrrh and aloe is what we used to prepare Jesus' body.
You're lying. I was at the tomb, and I detected the fragrance of very expensive oils.
That is because we were at Simon the leper's house, and a woman barged in and poured very expensive oils on top of Jesus' head. He said that she was preparing him for his burial.
I think you're a part of a conspiracy. Where is the body of Jesus?
You'll never find the body of Jesus, and I'm not part of a conspiracy. This is God. He has been risen from the dead.
No one raises from the dead. You are still a suspect. Do not leave town. You were the lead officer on duty. What precautions did you take to ensure the tomb was secure?
We knew that the mission was highly classified, and so I handpicked 15 combat veterans. And so we went to the tomb and we secured our positions, and then we took wax and we sealed the door with Pilate's insignia on it.
What happened that night?
It was the strangest thing. We were all in position, and all of a sudden we heard this mysterious noise, and then this bright light shone above where the entrance of the tomb was, and then this figure, this bright light came, and we all reached for our weapons, but it was just like we were paralyzed in fear and we couldn't move.
Who was this man? Iraqi? Palestinian? Roman? To tell me you believe in God and angels?
I don't know if I believe in God or angels, and I don't know what threat this Jesus was to the religious leaders or to the government or to Pilate. All I know is last year I had a personal aide, just like a son to me, was paralyzed and in torment. And I went to go get Jesus because I heard that he could heal people and deliver people. And I just told Jesus, you're a man of authority like me. So just send the word and I know that my aid will be healed. And Jesus did that. He sent a word, and by the time I got home, an hour later, my aid was perfectly fine. So I don't know what I believe. All I know is this man was good.
What did you do next?
After we were able to move, we ran up to the tomb to look inside, and the body was gone. We then called command and notified them of the situation, and we secured the area, waiting for the FBI to come.
Where is the body of Jesus?
His disciples stole his body.
So I'm supposed to believe that 11 men made up of tax collectors and fishermen maneuvered their way past 16 guards and stole Jesus' body? Do you take me for a fool?
I do not take you for a fool. They were sleeping.
If that were the case, then 16 soldiers were sleeping on duty, and all 16 should be court-martialed and put to death. I will ask you one last question. Did you bribe those 16 guards to say that his disciples took Jesus' body?
Yes, I bribed them to protect Rome, to protect the church from a bigger conspiracy.
What evidence did you find?
We didn't find much. We didn't find any blood at the tomb. We did find some DNA on the linen they wrapped him in. It matched the blood found on the cross, and it matched the blood found on the whip that they used to scourge him with. The only other DNA
found there in the tomb matched Joseph Arimathea and Nicodemus the Pharisee.
You can go now. Make sure no one else sees your report but me.
There's one other thing you need to know about his DNA. The human body has 46 chromosomes, 23 from the mother, 23 from the father. We can only trace 23 chromosomes from his mother. We cannot find 23 from his father. We have run several tests and they confirmed only 23 chromosomes from his mother. This is not humanly possible.
You mean to tell me that even Mary's father's DNA was not found in Jesus' DNA?
According to the report, yes, that is what I am saying. A mother's blood and her fetus blood naturally never mix. The baby's blood is kept separate from the mother's blood. The baby's blood is kept pure, sinless, if you want to say.
Make sure no one else sees your report.
Good morning. You know, I was going to do a sunrise service, but it snowed and it's cold out here, so let's go inside.
Yes, sunrise service is not going to happen today with the snow and the cold outside. You know, I've been pastoring First Assembly of God here in Scottsbluff for 15 years, and I have never done a sunrise service. Most years it is cold and snowy, so I just let somebody else do those. But I hope you're enjoying the movie this morning from the Word of God. 2,000 years ago when Jesus was resurrected from the dead, the authorities and everyone was still searching for the body to disprove his resurrection. But the evidence is clear that today, as it was back then, that Jesus is alive and well, and there is evidence to prove that he is risen from the dead because he lives in a lot of believers, including myself. And that's the joy there is in knowing Christ. Let me read to you here in Romans 8. And I'm going to start at verse 11 and go to 14. But if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, we are not debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if you live according to the Spirit, put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. It's all about life. And let me give you a definition of life, and that's transformation. That's the evidence that we know that God still lives and he lives in us. The Bible declares here that the Holy Spirit raised Christ Jesus from the dead, and if he lives in your body, you will live too. Not only when you die going to heaven, but here on earth, this transformation, this new life, this abundant life, it only comes from the Holy Spirit living inside of you. The other thing is, it's the transformation also comes from the Holy Spirit using the Word of God. This is my second Bible, the second one that I've ever owned. The first one my dad gave me before I was saved, it was a Schofield Study Bible. And I had that for 8 years before I got saved and started reading it, and I wore it out just like this one is worn out. That's the key, is studying your Bible and allowing the Holy Spirit to transform your life, taking you from the old you to the new you and putting the fruit of the Spirit into you. Man, I love the joy that I have every day in this relationship with Jesus Christ and allowing him to transform me every hour of every day. It's a wonderful life. And it says here, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. And what it's talking about here, it's not excluding women, for they are sons and daughters, but the wonderful thing here is when it talks about the sons in this capacity, it's talking about position. Because in the kingdom, the only one who gets the inheritance is the firstborn son. And so that is the level, that is the position that God is putting his children as in line for the inheritance. The Bible declares that it gives God great pleasure, good pleasure, to give us the kingdom of God. And the key thing here is the Holy Spirit. In fact, in John 3:3, Nicodemus, a Pharisee, came to Jesus by night. And he said, Jesus, no one can do these works that you do except one that is sent by God. And Jesus looked at him and said, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Yes, that's talking about heaven versus hell, but it's also talking about the kingdom of God living within us. The kingdom of God active in this everyday life. The kingdom of God expanding one heart at a time. You know, the disciples were believers of Jesus Christ, but they weren't born again believers of Jesus Christ until he was resurrected from the dead. When the Spirit resurrected him, he was the firstborn, and many sons and daughters after him would follow. And they would follow because they gave their lives to Jesus Christ and got saved. And that Spirit lives inside of them as he lives inside of us. If you're not sure if you're saved or not, or if you're born again, then I would like to help you right now. And that's as easy as accepting this free gift. And that's what this story is about. The death on the cross and the resurrection, the sinless life that Jesus lived to become the Lamb without spot or blemish, to be that sacrifice. And that sacrifice was important because he took our place, because the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. And that's all we have to do. We can't work at it. We can't be good. We can't join a church. We just accept the gift and give our lives to Christ. And if you'd like to do that today, if you've never done that, or if it's been a long time, or if you're not sure, then pray this prayer with me and God will do the rest. Dear God in heaven, repeat it after me. Dear God in heaven, I am a sinner and I have broken your commandments. I have hurt myself and others. But today I want to be saved. Thank you, Jesus, for taking my punishment. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross. And I believe that you were raised up on the third day, accepted by God as payment for my debt. So today, thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for calling me a child of God. And thank you for giving me the gift of salvation and this new life and this new relationship with you. Help me, Jesus, to live that life out. In your precious name, I pray. Amen. That's as easy as it gets. And the next thing is to allow the Holy Spirit to transform your life. And that is through reading of the Word of God, allowing him to transform your mind into thinking and acting like Jesus did. And another important key is to get with other believers. Find a church that where they believe in the transformation power of the Holy Spirit and where Jesus is Lord, and allow them to encourage you. And as you grow, you will encourage them. The last thing I want to do is have communion with you. And if you need to, you can pause it and run and get some bread and grape juice. If you don't have bread, get crackers, get a Dorito. If you don't have grape juice, get whatever beverage you can find in the house. So you can do that now. You can pause now. Don't go to Walmart because I'm not going to wait that long. But go ahead, and I would love it if you would join me this morning. going to be reading from 1 Corinthians 11, starting at 23. And the original Lord's Supper was instituted by Jesus in Matthew 26, 26, if you want to go back there later and read that. But I'll start reading at verse 23. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant, my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. So the Lord took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, Take, eat. This bread represents my body. His broken body had to be done because it afforded healing and wholeness for everyone who would accept him as Lord and Savior. The healing and the wholeness first for our spirits to reconnect, to restore our relationship with God the Father. Next, the healing and the wholeness for the transformation of our minds. And last, the healing and the wholeness for our physical bodies. If you're here today and you need healing in your body, let this bread represent the healing and the wholeness that God can give you today through the goodness of his Son, Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your Son, your Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, that you allowed your body to be broken so that we can be healed. And the healing is just as powerful, just as sure, as it was 2,000 years ago. So today we claim our healing and name what you need to be healed from today. Go ahead and do that right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the healing and thank you for the wholeness. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Let's partake together. The Bible says on that same night, Jesus took the cup of wine. And he said, This is my blood which is shed for you. And the Bible declares that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you. The word declares that the life of the body is in the blood. And your blood was sinless, Lord God, because of your life. The perfect sacrifice. The payment made in full to Father God. We thank you for your blood that makes us clean, white as snow. It erases all our sin, Jesus. It cleans the slate. It makes us new creatures in Christ. The same blood that when we make mistakes, we can come back to you in repentance. And it is still as powerful as it was when we first received you. So we thank you, Jesus, for your blood that also gives us access to the throne room of God in our time of need. This same blood that every time we repent, we should think that we can go into the throne room to be with our Father like if we've never ever sinned in our lives. The blood is that powerful. So we thank you for the blood, Jesus. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Let's partake together. Thank you for joining me today. And if you prayed that prayer, or for you renewed your faith in Christ, then private message me. I would love to celebrate with you. So thank you for joining me today, and tell somebody the good news of Jesus Christ. Celebrate with somebody today. So let's get back to the movie. You are Jesus' mother?
Yes, I am.
Tell me, who is his father?
His earthly father was my husband, Joseph.
So why did the forensic report say that your husband's DNA was not found on the whip that they used to scourge him with, or on the wood of the cross? I asked you a question. Answer me.
His father is God Almighty. Jesus was conceived in my womb by the Holy Spirit. You will never find his dead body because Jesus lives. He was resurrected from the dead by God Almighty. Like it or not, your sin and my sin, as well as everyone's sin, has been paid in full. Stop searching for a dead body and receive the everlasting life through Jesus, who now lives.
Stop playing games with me! Where is his body?
Oh, man. I am so fired.
The head that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty. The radiance of perfect love now shines for
bye. tomb with soldiers watched.